On today's show,
we're going to Game 7, baby! Game 7!
Yes, we are! We'll recap the Cavs' Game 6 victory and discuss Steph Curry losing his cool and his mouth guard.
In the up-down report, should Kevin Love come off the bench? And did Lee Ellis complete his challenge?
And the King has his fingerprints all over a very special edition of our Top 10 Plays.
It's Friday, June 17th. The starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Shout out to everyone joining us live right now on NBA TV or a little bit later on YouTube. We're happy to have all of you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Mellis.
People's opinions on sports change after every game. That's why it's fitting. It's National Flip-Flop Day.
to his right, it's the international man of mystery, taking it to the max, usually wearing flip-flops, Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lele.
Lele, and last, certainly not least, over there, that's Starters blog editor, Trey Kirby.
Hey-o!
Hey-o!
Oh, TK, what do you got?
Well, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at #TheStarters. And guys, last night's Game 6 was awesome. And while there are certainly lots of talkable moments that we're going to get to in a little bit, one of the best moments of the night came during pregame. And that's when J.R. Smith's daughter told us what she thought about her dad playing in the finals.
So can I ask you real quick, what is it like for you to watch your dad get ready to play this game?
Him because he made the championship without getting kicked off the team.
When they showed JR the clip in postgame, he started dying laughing, as I'm sure any of us would. But it brings us to today's question. What would other NBA Finals kids have to say about their dad? For instance, if Richard Jefferson's son, Little Rich, could talk, he's only 1 year old, I'm sure he'd say something like, I can't believe my dad is in the finals again. Last time he was here, I wasn't born. There was still a team in New Jersey, and Tim Duncan was still in the NBA. Guess not everything's changed. But we want to hear from you. So let us know on Twitter, what would other NBA Finals kids have to say about their dad? Send us your best answers to #TheStarters, and we'll hear from you a little bit later.
All right, get your tweets in. Fun show tonight. We got the up-down report, and we're going to count down the top 10 plays of the NBA Finals so far, because they are not done. LeBron James, he must love that Zaza Pachulia clip, because we are going to Game 7. The King followed up his Game 5 41-point performance with another 41 last night as the Cavs, they got off to a hot start. They held on for the 115-101 victory against the Warriors. The Cavs will attempt to become the first team in NBA history to win the finals after falling behind 3-1 in the series. But that's not till Sunday. So let's break down that Game 6 first, because there is no shortage of topics.
Mm-hmm.
And Trey, you got a few true or false questions coming from the Game 6 storylines. First one.
Yeah, our first one. LeBron James dominated again last night, putting up a cool 41-8-11 line, a game after posting a 41-16-7. Just crazy stuff. So true or false, win or lose during Game 7, LeBron James is the Finals MVP.
I think this is 100% true. He's been the best individual in this series. He had a point in this game where he scored 18 straight. It's almost
a
like
a critical point.
It's almost like we underappreciate him. You know, that was a quiet 18 straight, and he scored or assisted on 27 straight. How can you vote against him in any way?
Well,
right now?
You can't, but if they don't win, it's not going to count for anything, really. I mean, who wants to win that individual award? They're all going for their championship.
But even if the Warriors win, I mean, Trey talked about it today on the podcast, unless Steph goes for 40 and hits a game winner, you have to give it to LeBron,
right?
You don't have to, because you don't have to like the idea of giving a Finals MVP to a guy from a losing team.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the truth.
Yeah, but without LeBron, there's not even the Game 7.
And the fact that the Warriors...
That's true.
The Warriors are going to take votes away from each other. Steph hasn't been his best version of himself. Klay's not averaging 20 per game. Draymond missed a game because, you can look at it, like he wasn't a great teammate. Iguodala hasn't scored a lot. So there isn't one really strong candidate from the Warriors.
I like to give the Finals MVP to the best guy on the winning team. Maybe that's what it should be called. You know, I don't know. But I sort of disagree with you, I guess, too, Tess. If, and this is a hypothetical, if the Warriors win Game 7, and let's say Steph Curry has a 40-point game, very plausible, of course, it is Steph, his averages would be 26 points per game, let's say around 5-5 in terms of assists and rebounds. Those are really, really good numbers. They're not LeBron numbers, no. But those are historically still up there with guys that win Finals MVPs. Tony Parker in 07, Paul Pierce in 08. They didn't have as good as numbers as Steph would have in that hypothetical. So I would have no problem giving it to a guy on the winning team in a best of seven series.
Yeah, I think, we get bogged down sometimes what the name of the award is, most valuable player. I think clearly it doesn't matter what Steph does. LeBron has been more valuable to his team.
Absolutely true.
But, you know, best player on the winning team is probably what the award should go to, because how they announce it as well, you know, they're all up on the podium and Adam Silver hands the award. Is LeBron going to come out if they don't win?
Would he even want this award?
I know.
It doesn't matter.
I don't think so. I don't think he would want that, because what would you do? Where would you put that up at home? Really? I mean, it's not
a cool doorstop.
Real problems he's had to deal with. No, but listen, I don't care about the numbers. He is the most valuable. And listen, the guys who go home with the Larry O'Brien get the best award. That is obviously the best award. And the guy who goes home with the MVP gets the second best award.
He might have both trophies anyway right now. That's the thing. We don't know.
I think with the Warriors, what they have to go into Game 7 thinking about isn't stopping LeBron. It's obviously dealing with him, but it's, number one, get off to a better start.
Yeah.
And number two, deal with J.R. Smith, who hit 4 threes, and Tristan Thompson, who went 6 for 6. Those guys play off LeBron and just seem to feed off him. They were too wide open in this game. I think that was the biggest issue. We'll have lots of time to break that down, though.
Yeah, we absolutely will. All right, Trey, next one.
Yeah, after fouling out for the first time since 2013, Steph Curry pelted a courtside fan with his mouthpiece, earning him a $25,000 fine from the league. But true or false, Steph Curry should have been suspended.
This is false.
Yep.
He lost his temper. It was a bad call. I'm not going to get into the whole thing with the referees. It was a bad call. He reacted the way he shouldn't have. He shouldn't have thrown the mouth guard and certainly shouldn't have connected with a fan. But that was all just a heat-of-the-moment thing. And I think we can all move on from this and say, you know what, it was a wrong thing to do at the wrong time, but there's no way he deserves a suspension.
I do love how quickly the league acted on this. Mm. You know, early this morning, quite frankly, we find out, well, he's not going to get suspended. He's going to get a $25,000 fine, like most of the guys that have thrown a mouth guard before into the stands have. And Steve Kerr, of course, for his comments in the news conference after talking about the officiating, a well-deserved $25,000 fine. I just like how quickly the NBA came out and said, it's done, it's done. He's playing in Game 7. Let's get excited about it.
Steph Curry doesn't use his mouth guard anyways. What does he need it for? Just toss it. But you like apologies, right, when a guy misbehaves in some way. Like Draymond Green, you felt if he didn't kick Steve Adams on purpose, that he should
have
apologized.
Then he would immediately go and apologize. That's right.
Steph did a good job of apologizing right away. I didn't like the other guy, the secondary guy, who also wanted a handshake. You don't get a handshake, man. You didn't get hit with a mouth guard.
Sure. That guy actually picked up the mouth guard, too.
He did.
Very unhygienic.
Those things are valuable.
Yeah, that's true.
You can't piggyback on the mouth guard hit. If you get hit, you're the man. That's it.
You're the man.
So you're obviously going false with this. You want to see Steph Curry play, and you don't think throwing your mouth guard into the stands warrants a suspension.
No. The precedent says, as you mentioned, there have been other ones. It's not a big deal. It is a fine and only a fine. I think the bump into LeBron after that entire little incident, it's a tiny little bump, but he bumps LeBron. He just wants LeBron to know the series ain't over. Yeah, I'm getting kicked out, but the series isn't over. That was done on purpose. It wasn't a big deal. I'm not saying it warrants a suspension.
Yeah.
It's just a little note. When you look at that, he bumped him on purpose because this series ain't over, in his opinion, obviously.
And again, when you throw the mouth guard into the stands, you usually get a $25,000 fine. Ennis Kanter, 2014, he did something similar. You know, frustrated, shakes it out, chucks it into the stands, and that's what he got, 25K. Aaron Brooks, same thing in 2012. Nocioni in 2010. You know, there's a pattern of, hey, you throw that out there. We don't want you to do it, but we're gonna ding you some money.
I mean, you got nothing else to throw, really, have you, at the time? So it's just the one thing.
You wear a mouth guard when you play?
Yeah,
I've
never thrown
once.
No. It's good to see guys wearing mouth guards.
Some people do bring up, well, what about Udonis Haslem? Way back in 2006, he got suspended a game in the playoffs. But we need to point out, he got that because he threw it at the ref.
Yeah.
There's Joey Crawford right there.
He threw it at Joey.
And that, the NBA says, no. You don't bump the refs. You don't throw stuff at the refs. You know, you can't go overboard what you say to the refs. And that's why I really has some guts.
Talk about going overboard. Look at that ejection.
Yeah, you're out of here.
Yeah, but Steph immediately went over to him and apologized. You know, we didn't show that, but that was immediate. That was pretty quick.
Okay. So Steph Curry's playing, and I think a majority of people want to see the Stars in Game 7 anyway. All right, Trey, time for one more.
Yeah, last one. After becoming the first finals team in 50 years to even force a Game 7 after trailing 3-1, true or false, the Cavs are the favorites to win Game 7?
Well, technically this is false, because Vegas, I think, has the Warriors as 4.5-point favorites right now. But all that said, it's maybe hinges on whether or not Andre Iguodala is first off playing in this game and how healthy he's playing because of the back injuries that we saw in game six there.
Yeah, he doesn't look right. I think that's pretty clear, but would you expect Iggy not to play?
Oh, no, he'll play, but yeah. If he's the Tin Man out there,
yeah,
and he's not really helping them.
Look, the Warriors are favorite, as you mentioned, through Vegas, but at home, that's where they were almost unbeatable this season. But that home court advantage isn't quite as intimidating as it was during the regular season because the Cavs won their last game there. Yeah. Andrew Bogut's not playing, and you've already mentioned Andre Iguodala. So if you're the Cavs, this is the best time to play the Warriors at home.
That's fair. But the last time they had Draymond Green at home, they spanked the Cleveland Cavaliers coming in there. Steve Kerr said after this game, 29 teams would love to be in our position. 29. That means the Cleveland Cavaliers are included. The Cavs would love to be at home as well. They are the favorites.
Yeah.
There's no question about it. Why the Golden State Warriors should be the Golden State Warriors, in my opinion, though, there's a few reasons. Harrison Barnes not playing all that well. They're leaving him open. You got to hit a shot if you're being left open, or else you're playing, you know, 4-on-5. Harrison just has to find it. He hasn't found it these last couple games.
If you're Steve Kerr, you have to stick with him, no choice? Despite him going 0-for-8 in game 5.
Yeah, look at the other options. I think this is...
Brandon Rush, maybe?
Yeah, Brandon Rush is the other option. I mean, he only played 16 minutes in this game because he wasn't on. He did a couple other things. I think you stick with him. There's other reasons why you should be worried, but they are the favorites.
Okay. Let's hear from you guys. Jump on Twitter, hashtag the starters. Are the Cavs or the Warriors favorites going into game 7? We got lots more still to come when we return. Should the Cavs consider benching Kevin Love in game 7? We'll debate that and a whole lot more in a good old round for the Up-Down Report. Back with the starters into the Up-Down Report, where we figure out where the four of us stand on some recent NBA topics. Do the same on Twitter. Hashtag the starters, thumbs up or thumbs down. Our first one, as discussed, Steph Curry ejected from the court after throwing his mouthpiece toward a fan last night. Curry's wife, Aisha, turned to Twitter and voiced her displeasure with the ref's decision, tweeting, "I've lost all respect. Sorry, this is absolutely rigged for money or ratings. I'm not sure which. I won't be silent. Just saw it live. Sorry." She later deleted the tweet. Semi-apologize for being a little caught up in the moment. But are you thumbs up or thumbs down on Aisha Curry's rigged tweet?
We're all thumbs up, right?
Wow. Well, you guys were last time she was tweeting controversial
stuff.
Yeah,
I'm still up. I just find it hard to be mad at her for taking Steph's side. From her point of view, I'm sure she thinks the Cavs got Draymond suspended. Steph has been getting fouled every single game, all game, and he fouled out for the first time since 2013. Not to mention, he's the first reigning MVP to foul out in a finals game since Shaq in 2000. I'm sure she thinks it's rigged. It's not, but if she's caught up in the moment, she's caught up in the moment.
Yeah,
big deal.
We all get caught up in the moment. I was down until she issued the apology because we do react in the heat of the moment, and it wasn't the rest thing, especially.
Just don't go tweeting.
Yeah, listen, we've all had a tweet that we wish we could take back.
No, I'm batting a 100. I'm perfect. Every tweet is gold.
100. No, you're not. That's 1 out of 10.
You're about 70%. Anyway, the R word, that's what got me. And anyway, she apologized. She had a rough day. They couldn't let her into the arena. She apologized. That's it. That's why I'm up.
Just turn it down.
No, bro.
You guys are crazy.
The Cavs played better. The Warriors did not. Mm-hmm. It's hard to repeat as champions. And flopping gets you calls. That's what the NBA is. It's not rigged. It's a great league. Flopping happens. That's it.
Yeah, but I don't think we're agreeing that the league is rigged.
No,
we're
not.
We're agreeing that she has a right to voice her opinion on Twitter, which she does.
Yeah, that's three strikes. That's three strikes on her Twitter account. No.
That's the wrong opinion.
High road shade at LeBron after all the back and forth. Then she says, can refs get fined after game 5? And now she does this and goes crazy. I get it. She's worked up. She's into it. I love that she's passionate about it. But just like before you send the tweet, just go, what am I doing here? This is, what am I actually accomplishing here?
The rule here, hashtag never tweet.
There you go. Never tweet. I love it.
Yeah.
Get rid of our Twitter accounts. All right. But keep tweeting a lot.
All
right, next one. Despite the Cavs win, it was another long night for poor Kevin Love. Love picked up his third foul some 90 seconds into the start of the second quarter. That sent him back to the bench, though it didn't really matter, of course. The Cavs win. He finished with 7 points, 3 boards, and 2 assists in 12 minutes. But are you guys up or down on the possibility of benching Kevin Lue in game 7?
Ty Lue, I think, should put him on the bench because I think it's going to be a different scenario in Golden State. Golden State's not going to be down 20 to start. Kevin Love, if you watch the first quarter, he could have been exposed on defense. He worked his butt off, but I feel like there might be moments where he will be exposed on the defensive end. Offensively, I thought he was fine. He scored 7 points on 3 shots.
Yeah.
That's a lot of points per shot.
Yeah, per 36, 21 points, 9 rebounds, 6 assists. I think you just need as many good players as possible to win the final. So you got to at least give him a shot. If he takes himself out because of foul trouble or ineffective play, that's fine. But you still need him. Yeah. If you're going to win the final, yeah.
I just don't want to get off to a bad start.
Yeah, I don't know what the right approach is because he hasn't had a great series at all. And coming off the bench, maybe it worked, maybe it didn't. We don't really know. But I think why not just go with Richard Jefferson from the start and maybe have Kevin Love to give that second push, take a little bit of the heat and the pace out of the game from the first few minutes, and maybe he can find some rhythm then.
Yeah, defensively, the Cavs just look way better when Love's not out there because they get to switch everything and it neutralizes the Warriors' small death lineup a little bit more. I'm with you guys. You give him some minutes, but of course not heavy minutes. What's working, you go with. And that's what's working, him on the bench, which is wild, but it's happening. All right, a final one here, guys. As mentioned yesterday, last year we challenged Lee to take down the deli burger in Cleveland, the whole meal. Now, you killed the burger. You struggled with the fries, though. So we wanted to give you a shot at redemption. Just take down the fries. That's all we asked of you this year when you were in Cleveland. Let's find out how Lee did.
Here we go. Can I have a serving of fries, the big serving? I'm going to have to go to bar 3 for about 10 classes to work this off. Shout out to bar 3.
Oh, wow.
So good!
I'm getting heckled by the fans here.
You pull it off, man.
There's no better television than watching a man eat french fries. Oh,
so true.
Mark Burnett, hook me up. Wait,
thumbs up to thumbs down, man.
I'm a little thumbs down because you just left the trash there. You can throw it out.
That's fair.
You
gotta recycle, man.
Yeah, I mean, I was just caught up in the moment. Yeah, you know?
I mean, when you're doing it to Enigma, I don't know who that fan was, but it was great music.
Was it a strategy to stand while you were eating, too? Yeah.
Not really. It was more just, if I did it this year, then you won't ask me to do it next year. So
smart. When we return, we'll count down the top 10 plays of the NBA Finals. The king rules the court in this one. Come on back.
Exterior.
Back with the starters, we asked you, what would other NBA kids say about their dad? You've hit us up on Twitter, hashtag the starters. Got a few of the best answers, TK.
Yeah, this one comes from Marcos, who says, Harrison Barnes' kid probably says, will somebody help me find my dad? He's been missing for the last week.
Oh. Hashtag too soon.
Fred says, Curry's child, mom said the salt belongs in the kitchen, not on the court. And finally, John says, Draymond Green's son, my daddy plays kickball.
Good stuff. Keep
nice
tweets
zingers.
Coming, guys.
Nice zingers.
All right, guys. Thankfully, there's still one game to go of the NBA Finals, but that's not going to stop us from celebrating the top 10 plays of the NBA Finals presented by
Ciroc.
That's right. At number 10, Game 3. It's like a very solid fast break, Lee Ellis.
Nice.
The Warriors going the other way. Barbosa to Livingston. Draymond Green with the finish. Throws it down.
Yeah.
With authority. Nice steal there from Leandro, too.
Leo over to Shawnee. Over to Dre. Finish.
Two thumbs up.
Beautiful.
At number 10.
At number 9, LeBron's putback in game 4. Comes in flying. Wow. You're going to see a lot of LeBron James in this top 10.
Yeah, yeah.
He's been pretty good during the NBA Finals. He got a tech for that. No, he didn't.
Let's stick with LeBron. But on the defensive end, game 6, just deny Steph Curry there. And then he has something to say. Let's him know about it.
I like trash talk, LeBron.
Yeah.
Pretty fun to watch.
It is. Well, he doesn't bite on the fake at all. Yeah, I think we have a rivalry going here.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Number seven, in game number two, Sean Livingston's laser to Andre Iguodala. If Richard Jefferson had hair, he would have had a haircut.
Sideburns.
He has as much
hair
as his fake son. What a toss right there.
Beautiful. Wow.
Right on the money.
What a weird finish,
nearly missed
too.
It, Iggy.
Yeah, for sure. Great pass, couple more. Number six, LeBron James.
Oh, yeah, that's nice.
I mean, he's looking like Grandma Kane out here threading the needle. That's my grandma, she knits.
Nice.
Same game.
Oh, that's a beautiful pass. A
little bounce pass. What's he knitting, you think? A scarf? A sweater?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's getting pretty cold in Cleveland now in the middle of June.
Number five. Game five, LeBron was attacking in Golden State. No Draymond. Bogey left the game. Maurice Spates wasn't doing much. He was just mean in this one.
I don't think Spates tweeted a little baby bottle emoticon after that. At number four, Kyrie Irving put Steph on skates in game four. I mean, Curry's trying to stay it up, but ooh, Uncle Drew.
That's my thing, guy.
Don't reach, young blood. Don't reach. Oh, step back. Catch.
Smooth.
At number three, Sean Livingston quick dunks Richard Jefferson. This was real mean. Game five, crowd went nuts. You almost couldn't really understand what he did live. You have to see a replay, how he gets up.
I love the pick from J.R. Smith on top, too, on Kyrie. Oh, man, that was quick. At number two, back to LeBron. Game three, LeBron with the monster oop. Throw it high, throw it high, throw it high. Bang. I mean,
throw it anywhere near the rim.
Kyrie doesn't really even aim this. Close enough.
No. I mean, you guys want to take a photo of this? We can stop it for you. Okay, stop it. There you go, take a photo.
You think Kyrie was telling the truth? He was just putting it up anywhere? And...
Yep.
Yeah. I tend to think he was telling the truth. Okay. Yeah.
I believe him. At number one, more LeBron. J.R. Smith, no look for LeBron.
That happened in a finals game.
Yeah, this was spectacular. J.R., it's a beautiful pass. Was J.R. Smith throwing a no-look pass? Or maybe he was taking a sniff to see if he had some B.O.
Missed his radar, yeah.
Gorgeous, gorgeous alley-oop right there.
Oh, man, yeah. Top 10 plays of the final so far. Can't wait for game seven. One more break when we come back. Lili, very solid play.
Solid play.
Yeah. Yeah. Lili, who gets your honor for the game six very solid play?
Who else could it be other than LeBron with a beautiful bounce pass through to Tristan Thompson? He looks like your grandmother out there, Skeets.
Threading the needle.
That's right.
Making a scarf, making some little booties for Trey's new baby on the way.
Oh, yeah, look at that.
Thanks,
that's beautiful.
Grandma.
That's what I call a very solid play.
Shout out to Grandma and Grandpa.
Yeah.
He'd be mad if I didn't say that.
Really.
We recorded the Drop podcast this morning. An hour-long podcast. It's up on iTunes, Google Play. We go into great detail, of course, about Game 6 last night and looking ahead to Game 7, which is on Sunday. Can't wait. Mm-hmm. Unbelievable. Game 7 of the NBA Finals.
Can't
only the seventh
can.
Time in the last 40 years or so. 8 p.m. start on ABC. We'll be here at 5:30 p.m. Eastern Time on NBA TV to get you all ready and hyped for Game 7.
All right. Looking forward to that game.